2-2. Check 1-2. Hey, blah, 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 blah. Check. Hey, 2-1. Hey, 2-1.
Welcome to the Fulton Street Collective. For tonight's performance of We Tear Down Our Colisseums, a musical experience by John Dorhauer and Adam Dorhauer and the Heisenberg Uncertainty Players.
Well, thank you, Jose. Before we start with the performance, we're going to perform a separate original composition of mine, get in our proverbial warm-up tosses, on a piece that has nothing to do with baseball, but does have to do with memory and the unreliable nature of memories. And so I thought it was fitting for the tone of the piece. And this is our opener number, Catalpa. Thank you. As Jose mentioned, we are here tonight to perform our multimedia collaboration with painter Adam Dorhauer called We Tear Down Our Colisseums. And this piece was originally premiered a few years ago, back in 2017, and it was kind of my culmination of interest in music and baseball. And I've been a lifelong baseball fan, but I've always kind of been fascinated by stadiums and the architecture that holds the game. But I've realized that over the past several years, that a lot of stadiums get built, and then we convince ourselves that they are obsolete, and we must replace them. And so they kind of have this disposable nature. And so We Tear Down Our Colisseums is in some ways a love letter to baseball and the stadiums that hold them, but is also kind of a commentary on the disposable nature of them and what that says about us as society. And so over the course of 9 movements, we're going to profile 9 different stadiums that have held baseball at some point, but have since been destroyed and torn down. And I thought a good place to start would be at the birthplace of baseball, and that's the Elysian Fields. While not a stadium itself, the Elysian Fields is where the game of baseball developed. And on June 19th, 1846, a date that happens to be my birthday, not 1846, but June 19th, the first known game of baseball was played at the Elysian Fields, and it continued to be used as a place for baseball until, I believe, about 1888. So predating the modern game, but the birthplace of it. And so musically, I wanted to kind of set the pastoral imagery of this open field in New Jersey, but also introduce some of the main themes that you'll hear throughout the piece. And so the opening 9-note motive that'll be played on flugelhorn by John Rarick is a theme that will come back, as well as some of the sounds you'll hear, the use of 9, all introduced here in the opening movement, Elysian Fields. Thank you. The second movement moves us a little bit more modern. They don't go in chronological order, but rather musical order. And it is very much my home stadium from growing up. Obviously, I'm a St. Louis Cardinals fan, and so I saw more games at Busch Stadium, specifically Busch Memorial Stadium, than probably any other stadium. And so I had to, for sentimental reasons, include it in the piece. Busch was built in 1966, or at least open in 66, and was used until 2005. And what was interesting to me about the stadium itself was kind of interesting. It had the little arch shapes and around it, but it was very much in the older model from the 60s and 70s. It didn't have a lot of personality to them. But what I remembered about the last season was they were building the new Busch Stadium, which is the one that stands right now, but they kind of overlapped. And at one point in the old Busch, they put a little model of the foul pole that would be the foul pole of the new one. So there's this little marker that let you know this is where the left field foul pole is going to be in the new stadium. And that juxtaposition I thought was kind of fascinating, of like new replacing the old and cycling it out. And so I use that as a pivot point musically in a piece of music that starts a little bit more of an older style and then kind of suddenly pivots into a newer, and you'll hear that in Busch Stadium.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sam Pilnick on tenor saxophone. Yay, internet. The third movement takes us from St. Louis to another city that is maybe in the Midwest, even though it's kind of East Coast, and that's Pittsburgh, and Forbes Field, which was built in 1909 and stood until 1970. And Forbes Field is unique for being the first stadium, first baseball stadium that was entirely made of steel and concrete. And I thought that was fitting because we tend to associate Pittsburgh with steel, the city of steel and industry. And so in setting this musically, I wanted to try to capture that kind of steel-like metallic quality. And for me, the composer I most associate with that aesthetic, especially from that era, is Edgard Varèse. And so this movement is largely inspired by the sound worlds that Varèse explores in his music. And see if you hear those here in Forbes Field.
Thank you.
We're going to keep it in the same era and move from Pittsburgh a little further east to New York and spend some time in the Polo Grounds. So certainly one of the more iconic stadiums in baseball history. Polo Grounds was first used in 1890 and was used up until 1963, I believe. Home to a few different teams, but most prominently the New York Giants. Who were not, it should be said, were a very good team while they were in New York, but they were a lovable team and they kind of broke the hearts of those in the city when they left out to head out west. But the Polo Grounds was undoubtedly an iconic stadium with its extended center field. And there were a lot of iconic moments in there, probably chief among those being Willie Mays' over-the-shoulder basket catch, which is depicted there in Adam's painting of it. And the idea behind the painting is that even after the stadium has been destroyed, the lasting legacy are everyone's memories of the moments in those stadiums. And so even when the walls, the seats, the field have gone away, we're left with our memories of what happened in those hallowed walls. But one thing that I thought was notable but also kind of tragic about the Polo Grounds is when it was torn down, it ended up being replaced by an apartment complex in New York. And so I thought that was kind of emblematic of the disposable nature of stadiums and our desire in society to move on and constantly modernize. And so to set this, I wanted to kind of present that juxtaposition and do so in a way that made homage to one of my favorite pieces of music ever, Luciano Berio's Sinfonia, specifically the third movement, which is this postmodern pastiche of quotation all centered around the scherzo from Mahler's Second Symphony. And so what I wanted to do was have some kind of through thread and kind of layer a lot of chaotic elements around that. And so I found a song that Frank Sinatra recorded called There Used to Be a Ballpark that most accounts seem to indicate that it was inspired by the Polo Grounds, so that was perfectly fitting. That song kind of serves as the constant foundation with quotations from that song and another song kind of layered on top of it. I wanted to find for the second song a song that had something to do with apartments, so the modern take on it. And so I just did a Google search on songs about apartments, and lo and behold, one of the first ones I found was a song called Apartment by the group called Modern Baseball. And when I found that, I knew that there was my piece right there. So you'll hear both songs kind of interwoven against each other in Polo Grounds.
Thank you.
No, it featured James Baum on baritone saxophone on the melody there. We're going to do one more movement from the piece before we take a brief intermission. So it's not the seventh inning stretch, but, you know, halfway proportional. We had to fudge the rules a little bit there. And we're going to go a little bit more modern and all the way out to the West Coast for this one, visiting Seattle and the Kingdome. The Kingdome was built in 1976 and was used up until 1999. And it very much represented the phase of the 70s and 80s with dome building. So it's the dome representative in the piece. But for me, the implosion of the Kingdome is one of my more vivid memories from that period. Getting to see it on television come down so suddenly is something I still kind of remember to this day. And so I wanted to set that moment, but I also wanted to capture some of the spirit of the 1990s, both with the Ken Griffey-led fun-loving Mariners of that time, but also the grunge scene in Seattle in the 1990s. And put that together, you get our take on Kingdome. Thank you. Thank you. We're going to take a brief intermission. We will be back with the second set and the rest of the piece. So don't go anywhere. We'll be back. Thank you.
Okay, welcome back to We Tear Down Our Colosseums, featuring John Dorhauer and Adam Dorhauer and the Heisenberg Uncertainty Players, I'm sorry, because science. I hope while you were at home during our break, you were taking care of the band and the artist and the Fulton Street Collective and giving us big, fat, juicy tips. Let's get going.
Thank you, Jose, and thank you for everyone for sticking around. We'd like to pick up with the sixth movement, continue on from there. And the sixth movement is probably the most obscure stadium that I selected. It's one called the Palace of the Fans. Palace of the Fans was home to the Cincinnati Reds for a brief period in time from 1902 until 1911. And the main reason I picked it is because I think that its story is almost kind of its own microcosm of the story of the piece. It was built to be kind of this cutting edge, uber modern future of baseball stadiums, and was built with this really ornate neoclassical style with these large Corinthian columns around the stadium and with the actually early predecessors to press boxes. And it was kind of built around luxury. But the problem was it was very poorly made and designed, and within a few years it started crumbling, and within less than a decade became obsolete and unusable. And so the idea of this idea that started as this grand kind of ultra-modern idea that was so pretentious that it crumbled on its own pretentiousness, I thought was really interesting, and wanted to create a piece of music that kind of depicted that. And so with Palace of the Fans, you'll hear kind of a neoclassical type waltz that eventually implodes upon itself.
Thank you.
Going to keep it in the Midwest for this next one, Movement 7, and move to Kansas City and Muleback Field. So Muleback Field was home to a few teams throughout baseball, including the Royals and the A's when they were in Kansas City. But most notably, it was home to the Kansas City Monarchs. And when I was putting together movements and stadiums for this piece, I wanted to make sure to include at least one stadium that was the primary home of a team from the Negro Leagues. And for me, the team that personifies that era more than any is the Kansas City Monarchs. And with this one, I wanted to try to capture the feel of a baseball game more so than with any other movement. And so what you'll hear is not necessarily the sound of a baseball game, but quite literally sounds that are generated by a baseball game. And so what I did was I took a box score that I had completed for a game between the Brewers and the Cardinals, so not a Monarchs game, unfortunately. Could not procure a box score from that. But I took the box score, I translated different elements into musical cues. And so you'll hear different members of the band either representing different fielders on defense or batters at the plate or on base and doing different things depending on where you're at in the game. You can do this with any box score if you have the rules for it. So it doesn't necessarily have to be this one, but this is the realization of that game and Muleback Field. One last note on it before we play it. Believe it or not, there is a sing-along portion for this one. For those of you at home, please feel free to join along at the appropriate time.
Thank you. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jacks. I don't care if I never get back, for it's root, root, root for the stop signs. If they don't win, it's a shame, for it's one, two, three strikes, you're out. And
thank you. I will say that is the most applause that piece has ever gotten in our history. Yeah. Oh, yes. Something like that. For our last two movements, we're going to visit two classics that are united in the fact that they are actually stadiums that I was lucky enough to attend games at before they were torn down. The first of those, the eighth movement, is Tiger Stadium, of course, from Detroit, which was built in 1912 and was used until 1999, same year the Kingdom was torn down, actually. And Tiger Stadium was just, it had those distinctive Gothic canopies, but it was just a beautiful stadium in the old tradition, and one that obviously lasted a long time. But in setting this one, I wanted to try to set the image of the empty stadium and the loneliness that comes with leaving the stadium for good. And then there's just kind of this unoccupied memory vessel in a way. And so I wanted to set the chasmic scenery of an empty stadium kind of in its waning twilight years. And for me, the canopied roofs seemed very fitting for that type of reverberating sound. And so you'll hear that in Tiger Stadium.
Thank you.
Thank you. And that brings us to our ninth and final movement, and that is Yankee Stadium. Couldn't really end it any other way. Almost certainly one of the most, if not the most, iconic stadiums in baseball history. It was built in 1923 and used up until 2008. And in fact, the new Yankee Stadium not only shares its name, but also shares a lot of architectural similarity to the previous stadium. I think with the idea being it was so classic and beloved, they wanted to update it, but keep most everything the same with it. And as I mentioned before, I was lucky enough to see a game at the old Yankee Stadium. It was a very fun game in 96 when the Oakland A's had Mark McGwire. They were in town playing the Yankees, and so it was a very fun game getting to see him play and the fun Yankees teams of that era. But one of the more memorable aspects for me of that experience was, I mean, the game was great, but getting to the game, and especially getting back from the game, was kind of this exhilarating thrill ride for me, my brother, and our dad and one of our uncles, where we didn't really know New York very well. We were on a trip seeing 10 different stadiums in the Northeast over the course of 2 weeks. One of those stops was Yankee Stadium. So we didn't know it very well. We knew we needed to get on a certain train. We weren't 100% sure which one it was. We found out when we were on it that we were on the wrong one. We had to go all the way across Union Station. At like 11 o'clock at night, I'm like half asleep at that point. And so in setting that, I wanted to capture not only all the glory years of the Yankees, not only the exhilaration of living and experiencing New York City, but also of this very specific memory I have of attending Yankee Stadium.
Thank you.
We want to thank you for tuning in tonight. We've had a lot of fun getting to play and revisit this music, and hopefully you at home have enjoyed it as well. I want to take a moment to introduce you to the members of the band. On tenor saxophone, please say hello to Sam Pilnick. Alto saxophone, Kelley Dorhauer. Lead alto and soprano, Natalie Lande. Tenor saxophone and flute, Matt Smuda. On baritone saxophone, James Baum, the Saxes. In the trombone sections from left to right, Brian Mayo. On lead trombone, Michael Nearpass. On third trombone, sporting the baby blue St. Louis Cardinals, Andrew Meyer. And rocking the Homestead Grays, Jops Gibson jersey on bassbone, Dan DeCesare. In the trumpet section on the left, we have John Rarick. On lead trumpet tonight, Grace Mulvey. On third trumpet, Bennett Hines. And Emily Kuhn. In the rhythm section on guitar, we have Chris Parsons. On piano, Stu Seal. On bass, Dan Parker. On drums, John Wenzel. How about a special round for our visual artists, not only doing live painting tonight, but all the paintings that you saw as part of the performance, Adam Dorhauer. That's my brother. My name is John Dorhauer. We are Heisenberg Uncertainty Players. Thank you again for tuning in. Just a few words of thanks. Thank you to Chris, Jose, Nick, Harvey, everybody here for putting this on and doing a wonderful job as always with the live stream and always providing a great home for original creative Chicago music. So thank you to Fulton Street. Please give generously to them, to Adam, to us as well. I want to say a special word of thanks to Adam and my dad. He imparted his love of baseball to us. And it's because of that that kind of brought about this piece. And thank you to both of our parents, mom and dad, for always supporting us as artists. We're going to be back here at Fulton Street in a couple months doing a brand new show that's devoted to boy band music. We're going to do a historical retrospective on the music of the boy band genre June 1st. So come check us out then. Visit huplayers.com. Come see us. Come say hi. Come see us. And thank you again for tuning in. We're going to take it home.
Especially Crescent.